गुड आफ्टरनून शिवम।
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
शिवम, आई हैव लॉग्ड इन थ्रू फोन। एक्चुअली देयर इज नो इलेक्ट्रिसिटी एट माय प्लेस। मैं अभी आती है तो तुम्हारा लैपटॉप से ज्वाइन करूंगी।
ओके मैम।
You can play the main screen.
यस मैम, आई एम डूइंग इट।
Hello, Himanshu. How are you?
Hello, good evening, ma'am. Good evening,
good
I'm
evening.
Good.
Good evening, good. Congratulations and thank you for joining us.
Thank you, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am. Welcome, ma'am. Thank you.
Good evening, Himanshu. Nice to see you back with us. Amrita, are you here?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
We'll begin now. It has been very rightly said in the Rig Veda, and I quote, when there is harmony in your thoughts, words, and actions, nothing is impossible, unquote. A very good evening to everyone present here. It is my proud privilege to welcome you all to this interview featuring none other than Mr. Himanshu Gupta, alumnus of Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan's Mehta Vidyalaya and belonging to the batch of 2012. We take immense pride in announcing that he has secured 27th position in the 2019 UPSC examinations. So we offer you our heartiest congratulations and well wishes for this outstanding achievement. Bhavan's Mehta Vidyalaya is proud that one of its own former students has taken forward its principles and ideologies and has managed to achieve such a great feat. This is something that we shall all celebrate with the greatest of exuberance. And of course, sir, your alma mater welcomes you back with open arms.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for all of this.
Thank you, tech team, for that nostalgic and heartwarming presentation. I would now like to introduce our panelists for the day. Today we have with us Dr. Mrs. Anju Tandon, Principal Bhavan's Mehta Vidyalaya, and Mrs. Alka Jaiswal, Vice Principal Bhavan's Mehta Vidyalaya. I welcome you both here.
Thank you.
I would now like to ask Principal Ma'am, Dr. Mrs. Anju Tandon, to kindly deliver the welcome address.
Thank you, Amrita. That was a wonderful start that you've already given, and a hearty welcome to Himanshu. I'm so elated, so touched, I'm so happy. My happiness knows no bound to welcome a student like Himanshu. And I'm all the more touched and nostalgic because you were the first batch passed in my presence, and you've done us proud. So for all of us, it's really a very great moment, and we're so happy, and we congratulate you for your grand success. Himanshu, miles to go before you sleep. And I know you're going to touch the sky, and the sky is the limit for you. You have already cleared the UPSC with 27th ranking. And now you have to do a lot more and take yourself, your parents' name, and your organization's name to greater heights each day you work on this assignment. Amrita, I would thank Amrita for giving a very, very pivoting start when she says that harmony, according to Rig Veda, the harmony comes in the by the thought, speech, and action. And I'm sure you are a harmonious personality, and your personality is groomed by several good qualities and the ethics and culture of Bhavan that you have done so, all of us so proud. And I'm sure that the success story that you are going to share with us today and your preparation surely going to be an inspiration for all the aspirants who will be watching you today. So you are role model for all your juniors, an elder brother to all your juniors, and keep blessing them. Be in touch with your alma mater. We're really proud of you and we would love to be connected with you. My congratulations to you, Himanshu, once again, as well as to your parents. Please convey my heartiest congratulations to your parents too. Thank you so much for joining us, and I look forward to hear you. I look forward to your success story. So I shall be present here to just hear that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am, for your kind and warm words. And we will now be starting with the interactive session with our guest, Mr. Himanshu Gupta. And we look forward to the insightful answers that sir has in store for our questions. And personally, I am very privileged and I'm very happy to be interviewing you, sir.
So Amrita, who all are present? Could we know the students are present? How many students are present? They are on the YouTube, I think.
Yes.
Yes.
They are on the YouTube and some tech students are there in the team also inside the meeting room.
Okay. So that's nice. Thank you. Yeah, you can start.
Sure, ma'am. So the first question that I want to ask you is that we know you did graduation in engineering. Then what made you opt for civil services of all things?
I would answer this question, but for the start, I would like to have a deep gratitude to all the teachers. And that starting session was also very, very kind. And thank you, Anju, ma'am, for those kind words. And for answering your question, since you said that, yes, I did my engineering from Delhi Technological University. It was previously called Delhi College of Engineering. And it was my final year that I decided to choose civil services as a career option. One reason was because doing an engineering from such a college, it exposes you to too many facets of career opportunities that you have in future. And I got that exposure after I did my internship and training in a private job. And then I finally decided that I would choose civil services as my career option. And the reason for coming to this conclusion were many, many. One of them was the amount of diversity that this job gives. That is huge. There is a lot of scope for so many fields that you have, be it economics, be it politics, be it international trade, be it any kind of cultural aspects. So all of those things are combined in this one particular job that civil services offers. And I chose Indian Foreign Service in particular as my first preference. So one major reason was also because the amount of exposure that this service has, and even the global exposure that it has, that is also unprecedented. It is a unique job in a way that you represent your country at the global level. That is also a really nice opportunity that one can have in future. So that was all my reasons.
Wonderful answer. Very good.
Very well phrased, sir. Your love for knowledge as well as for your country, it's very motivating. So moving on to the second question. So was this
Jyoti
your...
is not there? Jyoti Devrishi, Dr. Jyoti?
I'm just
she is
joined us.
I'm just she is watching us via the live stream. No, I'll call her. She will be joining, yes.
I'll be calling her.
So, sir, my question, I'll be repeating it. Was this your first attempt to crack the UPSC? And if not, then how did you motivate yourself to keep going when you found out that you didn't make it the first time?
No, it wasn't my first attempt. It was technically my third attempt, you can say. So just after my graduation in 2016, I joined the private job, and after 10 days itself, I just gave this prelims exam once, and it was kind of a blank attempt because I did not know what exactly is the requirement of the exam itself. In 2016, I understood that things are seen in the manner that is the requirement of the exam. But I gave that serious attempt at this exam. That was given in 2018 after I had left my job. And there also, I could not qualify the prelims exam. But it was my third attempt, and the second serious attempt, you can say, in 2019, where I was able to qualify all the stages like prelims, mains, and the interview stage. And regarding what motivated me, I think there are two kinds of motivation. One is intrinsic and one is an extrinsic motivation. So extrinsic motivation comes from the external sources. You watch a YouTube video or you paste a poster on your wall, and that serves as a reminder for you as a motivation. But for me, it was a kind of an intrinsic one. So within myself, there was a sense of purpose that I want to clear this exam. I want to serve the nation in this role, this particular role. So that intrinsic motivation helped me to go a long way.
That is very impressive, sir. Your resilience is indeed very impressive. So next up, we have this another question, which is, well, quite important, and a lot of people are curious about this. Is it important to have a sort of a backup plan or a plan B when you're preparing for civil services?
Yes, definitely. I would say that it is important that you have an alternate career backup. And the reason is that every year UPSC comes out with around 1,000 seats for civil services. And there are lakhs of aspirants which give this exam. And it is bound to happen that so many people are not able to clear this exam and not able to get the required seat. So anyway, those people have to find some or the other kind of backup for them. And this was the primary reason that I chose engineering as my subject before joining the civil services. I continued for my job for around 1.5 years, more than 1.5 years, just to have a good financial backup, a good financial independence for the family. And then only I decided that it's the right time to prepare full time for this exam, because even if I falter at this exam due to some of the other reasons, I have something at my hand that I can go back. So it is important to have an alternate career.
Indeed, sir. It is important, as you put it, it is important to have a backup plan. So let us discuss something personal now. Enough about the civil services for now. Tell us a little about your family and how they supported you throughout this journey, how they motivated you and supported you.
I have a small family. I live with both of my parents at Delhi. And I have an elder brother who is in US since the past 3 years. And my father is an accounts officer. And my mother works in the Ministry of Communication, Government of India. And regarding the support, I think it has been a constant support for my family. It is very difficult to express those things in terms of words, because at every stage, I'm very fortunate enough that I have got the freedom to decide at every stage, and they have supported me in every decision, whether to choose the engineering college, whether to decide in resigning for the job, whether to pursue civil services for a long-term career, because civil services preparation is like a marathon. It is it may get to around 5 or 6 years of preparation as well. So So it's a very long period and it requires constant support from your family members. And the environment that I got at home, that was also very necessary and that was very conducive for study. I did not feel any requirement to go to a library and study. I got the environment, proper environment to study at my home, at my room, very peacefully. And also a direct support has also been there because I can recall one incident that in the mains exam, we write around 9 papers that are 3 hours each in the span of within 5 days. And it is a really tedious and an intensive process. And there are days when we write 2 consecutive papers of 3 hours each with a small break of around 1 hour within one single day. And in every paper also, I can say that we write around 45 pages of answer sheet. I used to finish up 2 gel pens within that one single paper. And it is very, very intensive. So my hands used to hurt, my neck used to hurt at every paper. And I remember how my mother was there at after every paper outside the exam center. She used to sit with all the pain relief ointments and all the cold packs and hot packs and all those stuff so that I can give the paper the next time. So these kind of support, this can't be expressed in words. This has been, without this, it couldn't have been possible for me.
Definitely.
Wow, sir. I think your family's contribution to your success is commendable and we all appreciate and applaud your family for supporting you through this journey, which has obviously resulted in this huge success. So yeah, you were talking about how exhausting your paper is, how intense that paper is, your mains are. So obviously your schedule while preparing for those papers must have been just as hectic, if not more. So what did you do to keep yourself motivated and de-stressed and refreshed?
By schedule, yes. I would say it was hectic, but it was, personally for me, you have a lot of time for in one single day. If you have the ability to manage your time, I think you can take out time for each and everything you have. 24 hours in one particular day is a lot of stuff. So for me, it was not a problem of scarcity, but a problem of plenty for me. You cannot manage time effectively. If you are given some task and if you are given a lot of time for that, you tend to procrastinate that because you tend to say that, okay, we'll do it later. But the challenge here is to do that at that particular moment itself. Have a good plan, have a good to-do list, and then do that in proper manner. So in terms of motivation, I think when you have so lot of time and you keep yourself busy, it may not be due to the preparation thing itself, but the supplementary things, like I pursue my hobbies quite effectively. I play percussion instrument like drums and music, and I read other kind of books also, non-fiction books, fiction books, and all those things help you in managing stress, managing anxiety, and all those motivation things also comes up accordingly.
Very well, sir. That was very insightful, and it was also very impactful that you are able to prevent procrastination and you're able to manage your time so effectively that you're left with a plenty rather than a shortage of time. And of course, we appreciate that you've followed your other hobbies as well, as gifted as you are in academics and in appearing for the civil services. So this next question in particular, sir, I think it is of interest to both parents and students as well as teachers also. So is social media distracting younger generations from achieving their goals? And what suggestions would you like to give to youngsters who spend, say, a lot of time on social media?
Just as the old adage is there, like people say that technology is a double-edged sword. So I think social media is also the same thing. It depends on you, how you use it. So there are a lot, I think for social media acts as an amplifier. If you are a person who gets distracted by small things, social media would amplify it in a huge way and you will get distracted. And if you are focused and if you have the clarity that you have to do such and such things through the use of social media, it can amplify that thing as well. It can be very, really beneficial to you. So it depends on you, how you use it. So for social media distractions, I think the requirement is to generate that kind of filtering ability, or in Sanskrit, we say Vivek, that discriminative knowledge that what is useful for you and what is not useful for you. If you generate that filtering ability, ability to organize those things and organize your thoughts well, you can manage all kinds of distractions and all kinds of social media things.
So I think it is safe to say, deriving from what Sir has said, that social media is not a boon or a bane. It depends on the user, how he or she chooses to utilize that platform that they have been granted. So next up, Sir, my question to you is, what advice would you give to students who want to appear for exams like NEET and JEE and to aspirants of competitive exams?
For every aspirant of the competitive exams, I would say one thing, that you should focus on the process also, because the journey is more important than the destination. And let's say if there is a mountain and you are climbing a mountain and suddenly someone comes up and suddenly someone drops you at the highest summit without taking the tedious journey, it would not be that much satisfactory as you yourself would do all the efforts to climb up that summit. So it is important to enjoy the process that you are in. If you are giving some NEET exam or board exam, you should enjoy your learning process. You should, the results may not matter. Results might, the results also depend on many other which are in your hands. There are many environmental factors as well. That is not in your hand, but what is in your hands is your journey, is your learning phase. If you are focused on your journey and your learning phase, it will not be that much of a problem. And in addition, for competitive exam, I would definitely say that in the end, it is a competitive exam and some are bound to lose and some are bound to win. And you should always be in a resultless manner. One's failure is also important. You should acknowledge your failure. And acknowledging one's failure, and it is actually not the end of the world. It is, you have an ample of opportunities outside. You see, we can see the case of like APJ Abdul Kalam or Abraham Lincoln, who have failed multiple times, but yet they are stalwarts in their own fields. So acknowledging your failure and getting up with it, getting along with it, that is also required for every aspirant for any competitive exam.
That was very well phrased, sir, because we all have learned today that enjoying climbing the summit is as important as enjoying the view that you see when you reach the top.
Yes.
And of course, as it is often said, where would winners be without losers? So losing is also a part of life. Next question is that, speaking of competition, we all know that competition evokes feelings such as anxiety and a sort of fear and apprehension of failure. So what suggestions would you like to give to combat anxiety and failure?
Okay, for anxiety and failure, I would say the first thing, as I've already said, if you focus on the process and if you do not bother about the results, it is bound to happen that you may not get so much of anxiety. Some sort of anxiety is also fine, because it generates a kind of competitive spirit and hurriedness, you can say that, in your way of study. But a lot of anxiety, excess of anything is bad. A lot of anxiety and let's say fear of failure, all those things, they need to be tackled. And the first step should be to acknowledge them. You should acknowledge that and identify that I am getting that feeling. Many people are there who don't even acknowledge this fact. They tend to say that, okay, this is the way I am, but But you, if you acknowledge that objectively, that I am presently getting this feeling due to these circumstances, and if these circumstances are removed, probably I will be able to come over that. So identifying them is the first step. Second step would be to reduce them. Now you have something in your hands that you can try. For example, you can try sharing it with someone, be it your elders or teachers or friends or even siblings. Anyone, you can share your feelings, that whatever you are feeling, that helps reducing it. Second reason is by yourself also you can do that by objectively determining the reasons behind that anxiety, the reasons behind that failure is, what that is. If you can, I think that a good exercise, a practical exercise would be to writing it down. You can write it down on your diary or any of your notebook that why am I getting these things? Why am I feeling this kind of things? So that generates a good clarity of thought also. So all these practical things can be done so that you can move away from this anxiety and fear of failure, all those things.
Absolutely, sir. I think it is mentioned in a lot of our Sanskrit texts also that too much of everything is very destructive.
Yeah.
So yes, we have learned this in our schools also, as you might have as well. So that was also very well phrased, sir. So next we would like to discuss something that is, well, a bit lighthearted. I would like to ask you to share some kind of memory that you had, some experience that you had as your time here at school as a student that stands out even after all these years.
There are a lot of memories and funny events. There are some learnable events, and I have been praised and awarded at many annual functions. I have been punished for many things that I have learned through the course of time, and there have been many. And to recall one, I think the most memorable thing was the official farewell that we had, and that event, that was the most memorable experience for me, because it was the last time that we wore that full uniform. It was the last time that we sang the entire prayer and the school anthem, all those things. And we took all the diyas and placed them at the boundaries of the India's map. Those events, I actually remember each and every moment of that. And the cherry on the top was in that event itself, when I didn't know, actually, I got the award for the C. Subramanya Award for Excellence in Character. And my parents and all were really proud at that time. And it was a really, really memorable experience for me.
We are so very happy to hear that your last times at school, your last moments at school were as memorable, so memorable and so pleasant. So now the next question that we have for you is that now that we've touched upon the topic of your time as a student here at Bhavans Mehta Vidyalaya, how have Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan's ideologies, how have its teachings helped you grow? How have they shaped you as a person, as the person you are today?
Okay, so this is going to be a long answer maybe. I remember a quote which says that destiny of a nation is shaped in its classrooms. And I think my destiny was shaped in Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. And being a future civil servant now, and I can safely say that I would be contributing my bit to shaping of the destiny of the nation itself also. And every Bhavan has inculcated some of the other core values in me, and those values have helped me pursue this journey. It wouldn't have been possible that I would try to pursue this journey itself had those core values not been inculcated in me through Bhavan. And I would start with the school motto. The school motto, which says "Ano Bhadraha Kratvo Yantu Vishvatah," this means let noble thoughts come to us from every side. And I have this in my life, and my action to gain exposure to a lot of things, to see different perspectives of single issues, to examine things in a very learning mode. And all those things are rooted in this one basic concept. And the curricular classes that has shaped my foundations, that are also very important. And you might be surprised to know that I still have some of the other, some classwork copies of mine. I have my 9th class economics copy of Mrs. Kirti Chaturvedi's ma'am with me. I have my chemistry notebook with me of Mrs. Aarti Chopra ma'am's. Those are the things that I have still kept with myself. And all those things have imbibed more than the other logical and analytical abilities. I had taken science with computer science with my as my subject in 11th and 12th. And I was fortunate to have studied from Alka Jaiswal ma'am, who is there in computer science. And that developed those analytical, logical abilities in me. I was able to, I'm very effective in using technology in my work. For example, even in my prelims preparation, if I had to analyze what I have to do or where am I lacking, I had made a program for myself, and I was using that program to analyze which all areas I was lacking and where I had to work on. And moreover, there are many of the I cannot stop taking the name of teachers, and all I remember each one of them very fondly. And I am very proud to say that this is a school where teachers are so approachable and so loving and caring for the students. I have talked to many of my friends in my college as well, but this kind of experience is, I think this is very unique in Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. I can also say there have been many events that are organized. For example, the SAS camp that was organized in school, the blood donation camp that was there. I also got the opportunity to appear as a scribe for blind students for board exams. And all those things also inculcate those social awareness and sensitivity around you, the empathy for the society, vulnerable sections. So those cultural values are also there. The morning school prayer, the Sarvadharma prayer, that was also some or the other way that has imbibed that secularism and religious tolerance values in me. So the kind of exposure that the school has given me, that is very unprecedented and very unique for me. So I think now, as I have come to know, there have been a lot of improvements in the school infrastructure, in all the other things as well. And I think it will be a great place for a student, and not only for the learning, but for an overall personality development.
Wow, sir, that was very heartwarming. And it is, I think, equally remarkable to see that a former student of ours still has that respect and that affection for his teachers. He still harbors those feelings. He still is a student in the eyes of his teachers, and he still considers them his teachers, his seniors. So we now reach the last question, sir. We want to know if you have any success mantra that you want to share with our viewers.
Okay. Success mantra, it would be quite paradoxical to say that, but I would say you should not rely on only one success mantra. My inspiration and my aspiration has been to gain as much exposure as possible, to see as much diversity as possible and as much perspectives as possible, and then only try to decide what I want to do, what I want with my life. So having only one approach, one single approach, might not be good at this particular moment for a student per se. So and only studies might not be helpful, and only play might not be so helpful. You should have a judicious mix of each and everything. You should try to be all-rounder first, and then maybe you may decide to become a specialist after you have decided in which field you should go. So try to focus on your overall personality. That is the success mantra, as you can say.
That was excellently put, sir. So I think it would be safe to say that you're saying that we should be responsible for our own success mantras.
Yeah, true. After an informed, you should only take an informed decision after seeing all of those perspectives, and don't only decide.
Absolutely. So awareness and information and knowledge is the success mantra. It's the ultimate success mantra.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Our panelists today would also like to ask you some questions. So I now invite Principal Ma'am to kindly address her question to our guest.
So Amrita has, I think, very beautifully covered all that we wanted to say, ask, and know. So Himanshu, I don't think there's anything left much. The way you have conveyed your thoughts, your ideas, your preparation shows that the kind of radiant personality you are, the kind of all-rounder personality you are. I'm really, really impressed to hear you. I'm so impressed to hear the lofty thoughts, the sublime ideas that you have at this young age, and the kind of respect you have for your teachers and your school. So I think Amrita has asked you everything, but I would, just being the principal, I'm concerned with the future of my children. So I would just ask you that what would you suggest to your youngsters? What habits one should develop? What attitudes one should develop? What values one should inculcate, and how important school is for everyone? So what would you tell your youngsters?
Ma'am, as I have already said, the school is the most important social institution that you come out after your family. So when a small child gets out of his family, the first social institution that one interacts with is the school. And correct. It is the very important aspect of one's personality. In terms of the habits and attitudes and values that one should, a student should inculcate in one's life in a student, as a student, I would say the first thing should be based on the character. That inculcates each and everything. So be it the discipline or punctuality, those things are the first step that one can work for. Discipline and punctuality are the things that school can very nicely inculcate. Apart from that, being organized, being not only from the outside perspective, but also from the inner perspective, from the mind perspective, you should also be very well structured and organized. Having a good clarity of thought that whatever you are doing, you are doing for something with a sense of purpose that you have. So all those organization is also very important. Another thing is maintaining good health. And in health also, I would say there are two aspects, physical and mental health. So all those physical and mental health are given in the form of, let's say, physical education or yoga or meditation classes, or all those things are also really, really important. And another habit that I would say is try to develop concentration and focus. Because as we already talked, this is a world of social media and maybe distractions. If one has the ability to generate focus and concentration, that is also very helpful for any student in his or her life in the future. So all those things are there. And along with that, I think what Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan has is the cultural values that it inculcates. That I think your tagline is also about Sanskrit and Sanskriti, and that is very, very important. You should always be proud of your culture and proud of our cultural heritage that we have. And all those things are really important. So reading books, reading even Bhavan's publications are there, so many based on many cultures. I have been fortunate that whenever I used to get an award from Bhavan, I also used to get a book. So I have got Mahatma Gandhi's book, Swami Vivekananda's book, and I have all of these things with me even today. So I have read all of them, and they are really, really great books for me. So that has also helped me develop some cultural attitudes and other societal values also. And that is very much required in a student.
So very valuable thoughts. And exactly this is what we tell all our students, and it has come from your mouth. So I think it's a great message for all the students to make the best use of the school time. 14 years is a very, very long time to shape up your personality, to make sense of your life. And you have very rightly pointed out all the qualities, values, and ethics that one should develop during these 14 years' time. And I'm sure all these values only helped you to take you towards the greater heights day after day. So I wish you all the best. I know there are many more success stories you will have to share with us in the time to come. And please join us on the alumni and be our mentor and role model. And keep connecting with your alma mater.
Oh, ma'am.
Wherever you are, wherever you stay in the entire world, be connected with your alma mater.
Sure.
So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, ma'am, and thank you, sir, because that was a very sapient conversation that took place. You have really motivated our students who are watching right now through our YouTube live stream. I would now like to invite our second panelist, Vice Principal Ma'am, and I think it is only appropriate to add that Alka Jaiswal Ma'am has taught Himanshu Sir computer science during his days here as a student. Ma'am, kindly proceed with your question.
Himanshu, I can still recall you very vividly as my computer science student in the class 12th B in the batch of 2011 and 12. How time flies and students leave the warm and comforting cocoon of school life and enter the harsh realities of professional world. The most rewarding and satisfying moment for a teacher is to see her students reach to the epitome of professional success. Coming to my question, already you have answered mostly all the questions, and Amrita has very wisely covered up everything. But still, since being a teacher of computer science, I had framed a question, and already she has asked that how did Bhavan inspire and instill logical and analytical skills in you that helped you in your technical endeavors in pursuing a career in engineering?
Yes, ma'am. So it is true that engineering and technical services requires a lot of logical and analytical approaches. And being a science student, from being a computer science student, that has helped me in getting a knack of that, developing an interest in those fields. So that was really insightful for me. And I would also say that I was the president of this science club, JC Bose Science Club. I was member of your TechEdge club as well. And I, in that role, I have been part of organizing many events like the science exhibition, or the in TechEdge, we used to organize the Devangata competition as well. And all those things have also helped me in gaining the kind of exposure to a lot of many things. And also learning many new things of science, of objective thinking, and maybe related to some programming languages or software and technology. Because at present, if you say technology is there in each and every domain, and it is very much required that one is efficient in handling technologies with him. And so it is highly required that within school level itself, if one is able to develop those abilities, it will help him or her in the future, maybe in the college or in the career, life career that one chooses. So all of those things in Bhavan has developed that mindset for me, that framework for me, that I generally see things in a very objective manner. Even in my preparation, as I said, that handling each and every subject in a very systematic manner, and analyzing each of these things, that where I lack and where I have strengths on, I can work on those areas. So all those things are also based on the analytical and logical abilities, which are shaped by the school and by the Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan.
Thank you, sir. And you both
very
have
well,
proven
sir.
That very there nice. Is nothing more educational than a conversation between a teacher and a student. I would now like to invite Alka Jaiswal Ma'am once again to deliver the vote of thanks.
So Jyoti has nothing to ask.
Jyoti? Ma'am, actually I've bothered Himanshu a lot for the last 1 week. I've bothered him so much that I'm actually left with no questions. But I would like to say that Himanshu, you look the same. I mean, exactly, you look the same. I can recall you sitting on the first desk. And one thing I would like to share, I remember you acting as a scribe. I thought ki you won't remember, ya aapko yaad bhi nahi hoga shayad. I remember you acting as a scribe, and you know, it is very difficult to find scribes, you know, because students feel ki this is going to waste their time. And I remember coming to science class and then, you know, asking student ki anyone interested in acting as a scribe, and you stood up. And I know acting as a scribe means taking 5 to 6 hours at least of your day. So hats off to you and all the best. All the best.
Thank you.
So you have inculcated those social skills also in the school. That's so wonderful to know. And that's so important for an IAS and to know and to have those skills. Even I remember that in my previous school, Army School, we had a team of teachers and we used to record the entire book for the blinds in the cassettes. In those days, there used to be cassettes. So we used to, you know, record, my teachers used to record, read for college students. College, there were so many blind students who were connected with us and we used to record it in a cassette and give it to them so that they can hear and prepare for the exams. So that's a wonderful activity that each one of us should connect with some social cause. And during school days, you have done it. That is really creditable, Himanshu. So,
and Himanshu, congratulations on your new drum set also. So I hope you have that has been delivered. And you have started playing it?
Yeah, I have that. If you can see that, I have that.
Oh, yes, yes. I bothered you so much. You know that now. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amrita. And very wisely, Himanshu, I'm really impressed by the way you have answered the questions and you have grown so tall in stature that... So I quote Malcolm 10, education is the passport to the future, for tomorrow belongs to those who prepare for it today, unquote. The vision and mission of Bharati Vidya Bhavan's Mehta Vidyalaya is to provide a bridge to span the past, the present, and the future, erected on the rock-strong foundation of the fundamental values of life by blending them with modern technology. Today is an incredible and momentous occasion when we as teachers and mentors find our students chiseled into valuable professional human beings. Let me express my humble gratitude to our principal, Dr. Mrs. Anju Tandon, for welcoming Himanshu Gupta today amongst us. It fills my heart with joy unspeakable to extend my thanks to Himanshu for joining us today for an interactive session, which would indeed be a source of inspiration and motivation for all our present students. I would definitely invite you for conducting a session for them whenever this pandemic period is over and you are also available. Let me not forget to thank our prudent student moderator, Amrita, for asking such relevant questions from the gamut of different domains. Last but not the least, I thank all the staff members, parents, Bhavanites, and students who are viewing audience for today. Once again, on behalf of the school management, principal, and the entire teaching fraternity, I congratulate you, Himanshu, for your outstanding achievement and making your alma mater proud of you. My wishes and blessings are with you for scaling greater heights and a greater future ahead. I thank you all once again.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you for the kind words.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir, once again for sparing some of your valuable time to join us for this tete-a-tete. And we all once again give you our best wishes for your achievement. And we pray that you succeed in all your future endeavors. And I think as Mr. Himanshu has evidently proven that his love for culture and his love for the ideologies and the principles of Bhavan, I think it is only befitting that we conclude this program with a shloka. I would like to recite the shloka now. Sarve bhavantu sukhinaha, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kashchid dukkha bhag bhavet. Meaning, may everyone attain happiness. May everyone be happy. May everyone see good things in life. May everyone see pleasant things in life. And may no one partake of sorrow or grief. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.